Hey, players, and especially parents, don't disrespect baseball programs just because they're not Division I. College baseball at any level is still college baseball. Hey guys, it's Josh, the 90 Know-It-All, coming to you today to talk about a subject that's really kind of near and dear to my heart. Mainly because I cover college baseball a majority of the year. I do college in the spring, and then during the summer, I do college wood bat league. So really about 75% of the time, I'm doing one of those two things. And then when I'm not doing that, I'm usually covering high school showcases and that type of stuff. So really, maybe outside of a game or two, which is gonna be minor leagues, everything else is college or college related in some way or another. So this is pretty important to me, something that I think a lot of people need to hear, need to understand. Before we jump into that, guys, don't forget to subscribe to the channel. It lets you know when videos come out. It also helps out the channel, helps us spread the word about 90 Know-It-All, lets us invite more people to be a part of the discussion about baseball. So you can subscribe either down below, or if you're watching this like on the 90 Know-It-All website, just right up here at the end of the video, there'll be a little icon, 90 Know-It-All. Click on that, you can subscribe. But guys, let's move on, let's get going. College baseball at any level is college baseball. That's something that a lot of players and a lot of parents just don't understand. They get into the mindset that it's Division I or bust. And that mindset is really harmful and negative for players. It puts a lot of pressure on them because they fail to realize that there are other opportunities in college baseball that are just as good, if not better in some cases, than a D1 program. Now, yes, if you have a chance to go play for, you know, UCLA, Oregon State, LSU, Texas, some of these schools, you know, Arizona State, schools that have been known to have significant and solid programs over the years, that's a big time thing to get an offer from a school like that. It's important. It's exciting. You know, that's something to seriously consider. But you also have to understand that even though you get an offer, it doesn't guarantee playing time, doesn't guarantee that you're going to be a star or that you'll even make the travel roster. You may be one of those guys who goes and works hard, but just doesn't have the talent to make the travel roster and suit up for games. It happens quite a lot. So I want to talk to you guys for a few minutes about some of the other levels of college baseball and why you need to understand that sometimes that is the best route. Now, the level that I cover the most is JUCO baseball, junior college baseball. Here in the Northwest, they're called community colleges, but they're really the same thing. They're two-year schools that bring individuals in, and a lot of times, these schools get looked down upon as being, you know, the bottom of the barrel, guys who couldn't cut it at higher levels, so they go do JUCO baseball, and the honest truth is that that's completely wrong. I've seen junior colleges that have been stacked with Division I players that for one reason or another, they chose the JUCO route, not because of lack of talent, but maybe for some other reasons. One of the big reasons I see is simply the cost of school. You know, when you go to a junior college, go to a community college, cost is a lot cheaper. I mean, we're talking thousands upon thousands of dollars cheaper per year, per quarter or semester even. It makes a huge difference. In fact, that's one of the things. You know, having worked as an admissions counselor for a number of years, my wife works as an admissions counselor, both at a private university and now she works at a community college. That's the thing we've learned is that education is education, but when you have to spend $25,000 a year for, you know, a private school versus $5,000 for a community college, that's a big difference. And so it's something that a lot of players do think about. And so when they get offers to play at schools, yes, they may get a 10%, 20% offer scholarship-wise from a D1 school, but that still leaves them with 80% of the cost they've got to cover, whereas they can go to a junior college, and even without scholarship, they're still paying significantly less than what they would have at a D1 school. So a lot of players choose JUCO not because they're not good enough, but because they don't want to spend all that money. Plus, one of the things that JUCO offers that D1 doesn't always is playing time. When you get into a JUCO as a freshman, the only people ahead of you are the sophomores. There's no juniors, there's no seniors. Your chance of earning a spot on the starting in the starting lineup, or at least playing time, increases because there's not as many people ahead of you. So you have a better chance. And especially if you work hard, learn the system, your sophomore year, you're going to get the benefit of the doubt to be in that starting lineup or be in a role that gets playing time. So JUCO offers playing time. If you're a freshman going into a Division I school, and there's already a junior in front of you or a senior in front of you, you're not going to get a chance to play unless you're one of those superstar mega guys who has a chance to get drafted after, you know, their 3 years at the school. You're probably not going to start playing, which means you're not going to improve as much as those junior college guys are. And let's be honest, practice is great. Practice is what you're going to refine and define your skills, but being able to put it into practice on the field in games with umpires and fans, that's where you understand just how much you've grown, how much you've developed. So really, a lot of guys who choose D1 as freshmen don't progress as far as a guy who chooses a junior college, because a guy at the junior college is getting that same training, same work ethic, and getting playing time on the field in live at-bats, live games. So it does make a difference. Playing time costs big things. Now, there are some athletes who also go to junior colleges because they just need help with their grades. Maybe they struggled in high school and they don't want to jump to a big Division I school because, one, they're afraid that they'll get kind of like overlooked, passed by, and get lost in the shuffle and really have struggles educationally. It's a very real thing. I'll be honest. I went on to college and struggled right off the bat myself because I kind of got lost in the shuffle. So going to a junior college where school, you know, classes are a little bit smaller, a little bit more, you know, family atmosphere, or at least more interactive atmosphere than some of these major universities that have, you know, 50, 60, 75 people in a class, it does make a difference. So don't look at the people who are playing junior college ball and saying, oh, they're there because they don't have talent. No, it might be there because they don't want to pay the big money for a bigger school. Maybe they want playing time right off the bat. Maybe they just need a little help with their grades and this is a good starting point for them. It doesn't always mean that their talent isn't Division I level. I mean, I cover the NWAC up here in the Northwest, and I will tell you that at the NWAC tournament, the eight teams that are there are packed from top to bottom with guys who are going to go play Division I, Division II, NAIA, guys even who get drafted to play professional ball. There's a ton of talent on these teams because these guys, maybe they didn't get seen. Maybe because they live in Montana and they didn't get seen by these bigger schools because where they lived, a lot of recruiters don't go out there for one single guy that far away. They got overlooked. So they've got the talent. So don't overlook junior colleges. Plus, after 2 years of a junior college, if you've gotten good playing time, shown that you can play, Division I schools are going to look at you and really recruit you because you've already proven you can play against a more difficult level, a higher standard of player ability, and compete at that level. So junior colleges are a great option, and I think that people overlook them way too often. Another level that gets overlooked is NAIA, and this drives me nuts because there are guys every year throughout the entire draft who get drafted from NAIA schools. There are some NAIA schools who legitimately could compete with a lot of D1 schools and beat them. Now, they may not be able to compete against the big schools. You know, you're talking the LSUs and the Oregon States and schools like that. But they could still go out there and be competitive. There's a lot of small D1 schools that aren't very competitive in terms of baseball. So don't just think that D1 means better quality. NAIA has that as well. There are guys, once again, who get drafted all the time. I mean, just this spring training, the Boston Red Sox hosted, Northeastern, an NAIA school, and Northeastern did really good against them. Now, granted, it's early in spring training, and it wasn't their main big players, but the guys they had on the field had played minor league ball. Some of them played major league ball. These are legitimate prospects, guys who have a chance for the major league roster at some point, and this NAIA school took them to the wire. I mean, was playing them really well. I think the Detroit Tigers game, they were playing an NAIA school as well, and the Tigers had to win on a walk-off in the ninth inning because this little school that people may overlook was competitive. They knew how to pitch. They knew how to hit. They knew how to run. It's baseball. It doesn't matter what level your school is. If you know how to do the fundamentals and you know how to perform, you can take any team to the line and try and beat them. So don't overlook NAIA. I mean, once again, players get drafted. It happens all the time. So I don't understand why parents and players alike kind of bash these teams and bash them and make them sound like they're not as good. Yes, there are the power programs in Division One that are above head over heels other programs, but that's the same in Division One. There's the top tier teams and there's the bottom tier teams. NAIA has top tier teams as well. JUCO has top tier teams. I mean, there are some junior colleges that have multiple guys drafted in the same year. I mean, that's how strong their team is. And so to overlook these programs, you're missing out on opportunities. And here's one of the biggest things that people forget. NAIA and JUCO money is still equivalent to Division One money. And this is what I mean by that. If you're offered a $1,000 scholarship in one spot and the other school offers you a $1,000 scholarship, they're both equal. They're both $1,000. JUCO money and NAIA money, it's still money. It's still money you don't have to pay for college. It's still a scholarship. Cash is cash. Money is money. So don't leave money on the table. And some of the best schools educationally are NAIA schools. Let's just be real. Division two, Division three, some of the best schools available for you as an education standpoint come from those other programs. And so find a school that fits what you want to do with your life and your career. And if they have a baseball program, go for it. If they don't have a baseball program, then find another school that has that program you want and go for that school. Don't limit yourself to just saying Division One or nothing. Because the second you do that, you miss out on like 80% of the opportunities out there. In fact, I think I did a thing or looked up for a video earlier that Division One schools make up only like 25% of all college baseball programs in the nation. It may only be 20% even. It was only a small percentage. So you're talking about missing out on hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of schools just because you say D1 or nothing. And it's a mistake. It's a mistake to overlook these other schools because they may offer a better education, may offer you more money, may offer you a cheaper education so that way you can afford it in the long term. All things that you need to think about. And when you start saying things like it's Division One or nothing, all those other coaches become disrespected by what you have to say. They feel frustrated by that. And you know what? Some of those coaches go on to work at D1 schools. And if they've already heard this from you and seen your attitude, that may affect whether or not they recruit you even when they're at a D1 school. Because they may get there and say, no, I don't want a guy like that with his attitude. I want ball players who want to compete and play. Doesn't matter where, doesn't matter what level, they just want to be out there playing. That's what coaches look for. They want that. They want a guy who go out and play the sandlot and just play with his heart on his sleeve and give it everything, even if it's just at the sandlot having fun with his buddies. That's what guys want. That's what coaches want. They want guys who give it their all. So guys, once again, this is a topic that's close to me because of how much I do cover college baseball. I mean, I get to know some of these players, get to know the coaches, and I've seen legit talent. I've seen a lot of talent. In fact, last spring during the NWAC tournament, I interviewed Reed Harrington, who is a part of the Spokane Falls Community College baseball team, the Sasquatches, and he had committed to go to Boise State, which is a D1 program, but he actually got drafted by the Red Sox and decided to go play professional ball instead. He was a legitimate pitcher playing JUCO ball. The guy could throw. The guy was a hard-throwing right-hander, big, tall guy. So there's real players in JUCO who are going to go somewhere and play well. So don't overlook schools, don't overlook programs, and really be open to anything because college baseball, doesn't matter what level, is still college baseball. And when you get done, if you want to go into coaching and you say, hey, I played college ball, you instantly have a leg up on everyone else who didn't play college ball. Instantly. So guys, those are my thoughts. I know I ranted a little bit, but this has been something I've seen a lot. I've seen a lot of players talk about why D1 or nothing, and I've seen even more parents talk about how, well, my son's good enough to play D1, and if he doesn't get that, he's not going anywhere. You're hurting your player, you're hurting your son, you're hurting them when you don't leave all the opportunities open for them in front of them. So, guys, I'm Josh, the 90 Know-It-All, coming to you today just to talk about college ball. See you later.